Light of this year, Thomas Mayo.
Jeez, put the pressure on, I want it. Kapukubil, Murubuai, that means good evening, my people, and I say that because I've heard about the great values of this organisation. The comment was made earlier that there are similar values to what Brother Alton here talked about for our people. So I also want to thank Alton for your welcome to country, brother. I pay respects to your people and elders past and present. It is an honour to speak here today. Thank you for the invitation. And thank you for, you know, lending an ear to listen to what this is all about. A little bit about myself first. I am a Korereg Aboriginal man. So Korereg are the people in the Torres Strait, closest to the mainland, so including Thursday Island, old TI. Some of you would know of old TI. Identify as Aboriginal on those islands. Kukugal, which is the island group in the centre, in the central group of the Torres Strait, and Erebumlay, which is up near Mayo or Murray Island in the northeast of the Torres Strait, where Koikimabo came from. Those are my peoples, but I'm born and bred in Darwin, which is Larrakia country. That's where I've always lived. I was a wharfie there for 16 years, became an official of the MUA in 2010, and still am an official of the MUA. But I became involved in this struggle for recognition and for a voice in around 2016-2017. What I want to do with this opportunity to speak with you tonight is I want to cover the longer history behind the Uluru Statement from the Heart. And the Uluru Statement, you all have a printed copy in front of you there on your tables. That is the Uluru Statement from the Heart. And the Uluru Statement from the Heart is what really set us in motion to this opportunity where we have a chance, you know, one of the most powerful acts in our democracy, a referendum. We have the opportunity to say yes or no to how we are constituted as Australians, what our constitution says about who we are and how our relationship is with Indigenous peoples. The longer history of the Uluru Statement I'll cover, but also the contemporary history of it. How this document that you see before you, which is a canvas about 1.6 by 1.8 metres, how that actually came to be in itself. There are a lot of lessons that we have learned through the history of our struggle as Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people, and you'll hear how they are captured in the Uluru Statement. I want you to listen to the real logic behind the proposal in the Uluru Statement for a voice enshrined in the Constitution. Then I'm going to talk about where we are today. So I'm going to wrap it up with what exactly are we talking about doing later this year as Australians at this referendum. But the place to begin, always, I think, is, and Alton touched on a lot of this in his Welcome to Country, is that, have you all seen the I-axis map? You know, have you seen the map? It's in all the airports now, and you've got all the different coloured First Nations, right? Hundreds of First Nations on this continent. Now, when you think about that, I want you to also consider that it doesn't just represent First Nations, but it also represents hundreds of different or unique First Nations languages. Now, I'm not talking about hundreds of dialects, because there's a lot more of those, but I'm talking about unique languages. When you look at that map, the diversity of unique Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander languages. Now, the reason I bring that to your attention is because we must have been masters of dispute resolution. Experts say this. We must have understood how to make peace as Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people, these civilizations on this continent and adjacent islands. Because how else could those languages evolve so uniquely, so many of them, on this common continent? And I'm going to recite the Uluru Statement from the Heart later, and I want you to listen for a word. It's Makarrata. Makarrata is a Yolngu word. The Yolngu people of Northeast Arnhem Land and the Northern Territory. A Yolngu word for the coming together after a struggle. It's a dispute resolution process. And so all of those nations and all of those languages would have had a similar word for a similar process, an understanding of how to make peace. And I start here because I just want to debunk that first myth, that this was terra nullius, that this was no man's land, that what I was taught in school and certainly generations before mine was wrong, that we were savages and unintelligent, uncivilized. Now, these things were wrong. So that's where we should start. Now, the longer history of the Uluru Statement includes that, and it also includes that, of course, as Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people, we defended our lands and we defended our families, you know, as any other human group would do. And there were massacres, and there were genocide, there was forced assimilation, there was all of those things. That's the truth of who we are as Australians. That is part of our history. And when this country, the colonies of New South Wales, Victoria, South Australia, Western Australia, the six colonies that became the states in 1901, when this nation was federated and became the Federation of Australia, in the constitutional dialogues in the late 19th century that led to that federation, the negotiation between the colonies that became the states, Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people were talked about as a dying race. And so after the Constitution became in 1901 the Federation of Australia, the massacres continued for decades afterwards. Those harmful policies and laws continued. And something I just want to bring your attention to in the Constitution in 1901, and is still in here, there's a reason I bring this to your attention, is the race power. Section 5126 of the Constitution is the race power. It gives the Parliament the power to make special laws about a race of people. Also in that original Constitution was the exclusion of Aboriginal people from being counted in the census as Australian citizens. Now, these things changed in 1967. That discrimination from being counted in the census was removed. Also, what was changed was the race power. The race power excluded Aboriginal people from that power. And so that exclusion was taken out so the federal parliament could make laws about Indigenous people. That didn't mean that before that, the parliament couldn't make laws about us. It just meant that the power resided with the states. And so, one of the early parts of our struggle was Indigenous leaders in them days, our elders. They fought for that change, and it was great to hear that Rotary was part of that change to our constitution. But you see, they fought for that change to be included in the race power. It doesn't sound like something you do, but they did it for this reason. The states were particularly cruel and negligent to our people. And they saw the federal parliament as a more benevolent parliament, and they saw that as something that would advance our people, an incremental step. And also they saw it as important to bring advancement for our people, greater equality across the country, for the federal parliament to take some responsibility for how Indigenous people were treated in this country. And it was a great success, those changes. It was important. Queensland in particular did not want to change, and that pressure from the federal parliament did make a difference in that state, among other things. Now, this also, in this time, since federation, as any other human group would do, right, we came together at times in aspirational moments to make modest proposals for fairness, for respect, for recognition. And so the Uluru Statement from the Heart is one of many statements and petitions. And I'm just going to mention several here just to illustrate this pattern throughout our history. In the 1930s, there was a petition to the King. William Cooper and the leaders of the time, Aboriginal leaders, made a petition to the King. In 1963, the Yolngu people again, there was the Yirrkala Bark petitions. The Yirrkala Bark petitions was the Yolngu people trying to protect country when the federal parliament was moving to excise a massive portion of their land to a mine, and they were trying to protect that country. 1972, the Larrakia petition to the Queen. Larrakia people of where I come from in Darwin. Now, in common for these statements and petitions, and again, it's just several of many, but what is in common is two things that I'll mention here. Firstly, that those statements and petitions were dismissed and ignored by the King and Queen or Federal Parliament that they were addressed to. And also, all of those statements and petitions called for political representation or a voice to be able to speak coherently on behalf of our people about how to get things right, again, for greater fairness. The 1988 Barunga Statement is another one, and I separate it out for this reason. It was Bob Hawke was the Prime Minister at the time. He travelled to Barunga. Barunga is a small Aboriginal community near Katherine in the Northern Territory. And again, the Barunga Statement called for a voice. The Barunga Statement also called for a national treaty, as did the Larrakia petition. Hawke promised both of those things. He failed to deliver on the national treaty, but he did deliver on the voice. And that voice was called the Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander Commission. Now I'm going to go back again now. There is another pattern throughout the history of our struggle for rights and recognition, and that is that, again, like any human group would do, we didn't wait for a government to give us a voice. We organised representation. We organised ways of practising unity to get results, to put pressure on the government to get at least some decency in our communities, the way we were treated. In the 1920s, there was the Australian Aboriginal Progressive Association. There was the Aboriginal Advancement League soon after, for CATSI. There were many voices that we have established. Now, those earlier ones that I just mentioned, they were silenced by pure intimidation, because the powers that be could steal our children legally. They could direct us to work without pay. They could exile us from country and from our families. They could decide who we could marry. The list goes on. They had complete control over our lives. And so those voices, the leaders of those voices, were silenced by pure intimidation. And then in more recent times, we have been able to convince benevolent governments to establish a voice so we could be heard. There was the NAC, the NACC, and, as I mentioned earlier, the Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander Commission. Now, those voices were all silenced as well. Established under one government, removed by the next. Now I'm going to use the Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander Commission as an example, and those that were conscious of politics at the time probably believed that ATSIC was a failure, that every other representative body Indigenous people have had was a failure. Well, it's not true, for this reason. Our voices, our representation, those representative bodies have never had the chance to learn from our mistakes, to reform when needed. You see, all organisations have problems from time to time. And so when John Howard was the opposition leader, he opposed the establishment of ATSIC. He said it's going to be another government or something like that, you know, a bit of fear-mongering there. But when he won power, when he became the Prime Minister, he did these things. This is important to understand. Firstly, ATSIC was a service provider, different to what this voice that we're talking about today will be, and I'll talk about that later. But ATSIC was a service provider. So we cut a massive portion of the budget of ATSIC to begin with. Now you can imagine what that did for our people. We were just still trying to come out of poverty, right? It was in those representatives of ATSIC, you know, it was a democratic organisation. They were trying to lift our communities. It was the first time we had something like this, that sort of self-determination. In their lifetimes, like my father's, wasn't counted as a citizen. You know, couldn't buy a home, all these sorts of things. Now, when that funding was taken away, it caused our people to fight over what was left, to lift their communities. It was a bit of divide and conquer there. Further, the great things that ATSIC was doing, and it was doing some really good work, those things weren't celebrated. And also its problems, and it had problems. It had problems. But all organisations have problems from time to time. Whether it's a union or a church or a corporation or a club. But you amend the rules, right? You reform. You take care of the issues. If it's got democratic processes, then democracy needs to run its course and people need an opportunity to choose better leaders. If people are corrupt, they're breaking the law, then the law should deal with them. But you see, the good things that it was doing were not celebrated and its problems were amplified to soften up the Australian public, to eventually silence that voice as well. Now, there was a review done into ATSIC. And that review, two Conservatives were appointed, and Auntie Jackie Huggins, an Indigenous leader from Queensland. That review did not deliver on what was expected, which was that ATSIC would be recommended to be shut down. It was Hannaford who led that report. The Hannaford report said that ATSIC needs to continue, but it needs some reform. Now, as soon as the Latham Labor opposition supported Howard's wishes to destroy it, it was destroyed with the stroke of a pen. Now, what happens when a people don't have a voice? You know, whether it's workers or an industry association, you know? When people don't have a voice, they're easily exploited, ignored, degraded, divided. And so when we lost that voice, what happened was predictable. Things got worse. And so this brings us now to the more contemporary history of the Uluru Statement. When ATSIC was destroyed, the gap got wider. Things got worse. And so in this crisis, 39 Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander leaders in 2015 called for a meeting with the Prime Minister, it was Tony Abbott at the time, and the opposition leader, it was Shorten. And they said in this meeting, that was at Kirribilli, and they made the Kirribilli statement, it said two things. Firstly, it said when it comes to constitutional recognition, we don't seek a merely symbolic form of recognition. We seek a form of recognition, constitutional recognition, that is substantive. A form of recognition that gives our people greater fairness. Secondly, it said that we want a referendum council established, because they didn't want this discussion to die at that meeting, but to continue and lead to something. And so this referendum council was established to take the question to Indigenous communities around the country and the broader Australian public. And it was established with bipartisanship. But that question was, what form of recognition could we accept? So what happened then? Was a referendum council was established. There were 12 regional dialogues covering the entire continent and adjacent islands. There was 100 Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander participants at each of those meetings, not to exclude anyone, but to ensure there was a cross-section of experiences and perspectives, to ensure that it wasn't just the loudest of our people that were used to protesting to dominate the discussions, but also the quieter advocates, the healers, the people doing the frontline services, and also for cultural authority being in the room. And so these dialogues happened around the country. They did great work over 3 days. Well-informed, an understanding of civics was part of it. There were experts to answer our questions during the 3 days. And two things happened at the end. They endorsed an accurate record of meeting. And then finally, they elected delegates to come together in the heart of the nation at Uluru for a culminating convention. Now, there was 270 Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people that came together at Uluru, and that is where the Uluru Statement came from. We had three more days of debate and discussion, and it was passionate, of course. You know, you get a bunch of 300 people together, talking about the rule book of the nation, no less, then you're going to have some passionate debate. Around 20 of 270 walked out on the second day, but 250 remained, and we did the hard work to build a consensus. And on the third and final morning, we heard the Uluru Statement from the Heart read for the first time after we worked on it through the night and into the early hours of the morning, and it was endorsed with standing acclamation and tears of joy and hope. Now I'll recite the Uluru Statement, and I hope you feel what we felt in that room on the 26th of May 2017. We gathered the 2017 National Constitutional Convention, coming from all points of the southern sky, make this statement from the heart. Our Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander tribes were the first sovereign nations of the Australian continent and its adjacent islands, and possessed it under our own laws and customs. This our ancestors did according to the reckoning of our culture from the creation, according to the common law from time immemorial, and according to science more than 60,000 years ago. This sovereignty is a spiritual nation, the ancestral tie between the land or Mother Nature and the Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples who were born therefrom, remain attached thereto, and must one day return thither to be united with our ancestors. This link is the basis of the ownership of the soil, or better, of sovereignty. It has never been ceded or extinguished, and it coexists with the sovereignty of the Crown. How could it be otherwise that a people's possessed the land for 60 millennia and this sacred link should disappear from world history in merely the last 200 years? With substantive constitutional change and structural reform, we believe this ancient sovereignty can shine through as a fuller expression of Australia's nationhood. Proportionately, we are the most incarcerated people on the planet. We are not an innately criminal people. Our children are alien from their families at unprecedented rates. This cannot be because we have no love for them. And our youth languish in detention in obscene numbers. They should be our hope for the future. These dimensions of our crisis tell plainly the structural nature of our problem. This is the torment of our powerlessness. We seek constitutional reforms to empower our people and take a rightful place in our own country. When we have power over our destiny, our children will flourish, they will walk in two worlds, and their culture will be a gift to their country. We call for the establishment of a First Nations voice enshrined in the Constitution. Makarrata is the culmination of our agenda, the coming together after a struggle. It captures our aspirations for a fair and truthful relationship with the people of Australia and a better future for our children based on justice and self-determination. We seek a Makarrata Commission to supervise a process of agreement making between governments and First Nations and truth-telling about our history. In 1967, we were counted. In 2017, we seek to be heard. We leave base camp and start our trek across this vast country. We invite you to walk with us in a movement of the Australian people for a better future. Let's see your response. Thank you. Look, I went through that longer history and more contemporary history for this reason. Firstly, I want you to understand that this is not a proposal, this is not an idea of Albanese's, it's not a political party's idea, this isn't a Canberra voice. This is an idea that came from Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people ourselves. Because we understand the lessons that we have learned throughout the history of our struggle. That if every statement and petition before it has been ignored, then we need to address this one to the Australian people to decide. Secondly, that we need a voice, because things get worse when our voice is taken away. All of the evidence shows that the best outcomes are when policies and laws that affect us are made with us. And also, that if we are, when we establish a voice, we must do it differently. We must learn that every other voice was silenced by hostile governments that always come along. And the Constitution is the only place that we can put it, so that it is out of the reach of hostile governments and it can last and improve and evolve, and we can develop and get better outcomes. So that is the lessons that go into this. We have done so much hard work to create this opportunity for you to go to the ballot box later this year. Not only the hard work of learning those lessons and learning from broken promises and all of those things, but also the work to reach a consensus. That was hard in itself. Don't underestimate just how much effort that took for us to reach that agreement. And then there was the hard work to not take no for an answer. Because as those other statements and petitions, as with them, this one too was dismissed almost immediately. So for 5 years, we have worked to take this to the Australian people and build enough of a people's movement to the point last year where a Prime Minister, a government was elected that committed to the Uluru Statement in full. So this referendum will be held later this year, I think most probably mid-October, but that's not for certain. But it's imminent. If it is mid-October, then we're talking only around 15 weeks until it's done. And so it's urgent. And it's tough to win referenda in this country. Only 8 out of 44 have ever been successful. And none of them have succeeded without bipartisan support. So we are fighting this uphill as Australians that believe that we should recognise Indigenous people with a voice. So what are you actually voting for? Let me bring this absolutely with great clarity, what we are saying yes or no to later this year. The question is going to be basically this: do you approve an alteration to the Constitution to recognise Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people as the first peoples of Australia with a voice? The change to the Constitution is only going to be 92 words, and this is all the detail. In recognition of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples as the first peoples of Australia, one, there shall be an Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander voice. Two, the Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander voice may make representations to the Parliament and Executive Government on matters relating to Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people. And three, the Parliament decides the rest: the composition, powers, functions and procedures, all matters relating to the voice. So here it is. This is the detail. All we are voting on is if we should recognise Indigenous people, that first part, by giving us a voice that can make representations on matters that relate to us. That is what we're saying yes or no to. We entrust the Parliament, people like Patrick, who we hold to account through elections, to decide the rest. And that is how our Constitution works. To make sure that's abundantly clear. Tax laws. So the Parliament is empowered to make laws for the collection of tax, but in the Constitution is not how much tax, how the tax commissioner is chosen, all those details. We entrust the Parliament to decide those things because they need to be flexible, okay? You heard in those words that I said, there is no right to veto the Parliament, there is no third chamber to Parliament. It cannot force the government to decide where they park their submarines or how many they have, you know, these sorts of things, or what parking fines are going to be. It's advice to the Parliament about what matters to our communities most. And of course, that will be health, education, employment, all those types of things. And even if our representatives went for something that was stronger than what people were willing to accept in that time, the Parliament can say no, okay? So I hope that this has made it clear. Recognition, representation, that's what we're saying yes or no to. And I think, I believe that aligns with what the rotary values are, the four-way test. If you applied this, is it the truth? Is it fair? Will it build goodwill? Will it be beneficial to all concerned? The answer is yes to all of those things, and I hope that translates in your vote later this year. Thank you.